Well, let's we will roll right into this.
Let's do it.
We are live on Zoom and on LinkedIn, and it looks like we've got a really nice group that's assembled today. I want to introduce myself. I'm Michael Goldberg. I'm our executive director for the Veale Institute for Entrepreneurship here at Case Western Reserve University. I'm also a professor at the Weatherhead School of Management. We are thrilled to welcome Kathy to today's Entrepreneurship Speaker Series. When we have an alum, we call it the Case Western Reserve Alumni Entrepreneurship Speaker Series. For those that were joining and hearing our kind of pregame banter, today's session is co-sponsored by our friends at the UCLA Anderson School of Management and Elaine Hagen, who we recently met at a conference, who's the Associate Dean for Entrepreneurial Initiatives. We were looking for ways to collaborate and realize that we had a joint alum. So Elaine, I wanted to thank you for your partnership. Okay, we are hearing someone. Mute someone there. And Elaine, I don't know if you wanted to come off mute and introduce yourself in UCLA and talk a little bit about
what you do. Thanks for letting us tag along. Michael and I kept bumping into each other at every single session and in the elevator. And he just said, let's just get our teams together and maybe we can do some things together with our students as well. And haven't seen Kathy for a long time. And it's just really funny. Kathy was thinking about going to business school and moving to another city. And one of our board members said, why haven't you looked at that school in your own backyard? And, just much like Michael and I met, like serendipity really has a lot to do with entrepreneurs and life outcomes. So thanks for having us.
Yeah.
Awesome. Well, it's great and look forward. We learned a lot from the work that Elaine's been doing it a little longer than we have here at the Veale Institute. So we look forward to continuing to learn from each other and find ways to collaborate. With that, let me turn it over to Nikhil Vasireddy, who is a Case alum and a current first year medical student, and he's in our Entrepreneurship Pathways program. And Nikhil and I recently learned that we both have a love of the wonderful Subway hoagies at Hoagie Haven in Princeton. So besides that, Nikhil's a really talented, innovative young medical student, and we're thrilled that he's representing his Pathways group and is our moderator today. So I'll turn it over to Nikhil, who introduced himself and then introduced Kathy. And we love these sessions to be interactive. I know Kathy's going to present and walk through some slides to kind of give an overview, and then we want to hear from you. So if you're on Zoom, obviously let us know right here, either in the chat or by raising your hand. If you have a question, Nikhil will call on you. And if you're watching on LinkedIn Live, just put your question in the comment, and then Julia and I will monitor that and make sure that Nikhil knows about it. So with that, over to you, Nikhil.
Thank you, Michael. My name is Nikhil. I'm a first year medical student originally from New Jersey. And I'm representing the Health Innovation Pathway, which has first to fourth year medical students at Case Western. And we're trying to bring people on to impart wisdom on us to learn how to be health entrepreneurs. And today we're joined by Dr. Kathy Magliato. She's one of the few female cardiothoracic surgeons in the world, as well as a heart and lung transplant surgeon. She has a keen interest in promoting women's health, and she's currently on staff at Providence St. John's Medical Center in Santa Monica, California. And she developed a women's health center there to address the cardiac needs of female patients. Currently, she's also the president of the American Heart Association's Western States Regional Board. Dr. Magliato graduated from Union College and then earned her medical degree with AOA honors here at Case Western. And then she went on to train at Akron General, University of Michigan, Loyola University, and the University of Pittsburgh. She then earned her executive MBA at UCLA Anderson School of Business and received their Inspirational Alumni Award. Dr. Magliato is an entrepreneur and recognized by Goldman Sachs as one of the 100 most intriguing entrepreneurs in the US. She's the founder, CEO, and CMO of her own biotech company. She has been highlighted by several major media networks and features in shows by Barbara Walters, Oprah Winfrey, Martha Stewart, Dr. Oz, John Oliver, and Nat Geo. Dr. Magliato is the author of her own memoir, Heart Matters, which is a New York Times bestseller, and was then transformed into a NBC show called Heartbeat, which she executively produced. So here to discuss her journey, please welcome Dr. Kathy Magliato.
Thank you. Thanks, Akhil. And thank you, everyone, for inviting me. The one question I'm not going to answer is which institution I like better, Case Western Reserve or UCLA. But I just think it's so lovely, Michael, that we're able to put together this joint discussion. And to Nikhil's point, I do a lot of things in my life as a heart surgeon entrepreneur. I'm just going to spend a little bit of time talking a bit about my journey, and I'm going to interlace through that some of the things that I've learned about leadership, you know, leadership in an OR versus leadership in a boardroom and leadership, running a company. And so on this slide, my opening slide, you see I've listed, you know, basically all the things underneath my title. And I didn't leave out, you know, wife and mommy, and I'm willing to take questions on any and all of this. So feel free to ask me about my show, my book, my company, my kids, my husband. It's, you know, I guess I am an open book, and I'm happy to take questions on any and all of that. So somehow I'm not able to advance this. Sorry, I have to advance it manually. So I wanted to start off, this is a poster from my show. As Nikhil mentioned, I had a television show based on my life on NBC called Heartbeat. You can find it on, I think on Netflix. And this is the beautiful Melissa George. I wish I looked this good in an operating room, but I don't. And I put this up because if any of you listening in today have seen Heartbeat, I just want you to be aware that this was a show, and I'm going to use my laser quotes, loosely based on my life. And so, you know, don't believe everything you see, because I came home one day and my husband said to me, excuse me, are you having an affair with four guys at the hospital? And I said to my husband, you know, Nick, no, I'm only having an affair with two guys at the hospital. It's loosely based on my life. So anyway, I will just put that out there. I hope you enjoy the show as much as I did creating it. And I spent a lot of time on set. This is Melissa and I on set. And one thing I found very intriguing producing this show is that the set is run very, very similar to how we run an operating room. You know, there's a lot going on, but everybody is very subspecialized on set. And it all just comes together to create, you know, 42 minutes of film every week by everybody doing their part to the best of their ability. And that's exactly what happens in an OR. And we'll talk about it. But the folks that I loved best on set, just to share, were the folks that were called the blood guys. So these were the people that had all the fake blood, and they would yell out, "We need the blood guys." And they would come and dose the set with buckets of blood. And I'm telling you, it could have been a show about a serial killer, but it was a show about a heart surgeon. And I kept having to explain to them, we actually want to see less blood in an OR, less blood, not more blood. But it was really a blast. And I'm happy to talk to you about what it was like to do something like that, really out of my comfort zone. And speaking of out of my comfort zone, this slide, you know, look at me, I'm so young. That's when I first, you know, showed up as a newly minted heart surgeon. I had done a fellowship in heart and lung transplantation and artificial heart technology at the University of Pittsburgh. And this was my first job at Cedars-Sinai Medical Center. And this was the transplant team. And what should be pretty obvious to you ladies who are listening in is I was the only woman in the department, and quite frankly, I was the only woman to train at every single institution I trained at. So less than 3% of heart surgeons are women, so it's a pretty rare thing. And yet, if we've got medical students out there that are on the fence about, you know, becoming a heart surgeon, I'm here to tell you it's fabulous. And to do it, you know, forget about the appendix or the bowel or breast or any of the other organs. The heart is the only place to be. Now, as rare as it is for me to be a heart surgeon, it's actually more rare for me to be the CEO of a medical technology startup company. This is our org chart for my company. And to be a founder and CEO of a med tech startup and to have raised all the capital for the company is actually extremely rare as a woman. It's 2.7% of all startups. So I have made a decision that anything 3% or less, I'm doing it. So next week, I'm either going to be an astronaut or a Kardashian, and frankly, could go either way. So stay tuned on that. Stay tuned on that. So my next slides, sorry, but this is for the med students. All the entrepreneurs are, you know, fainting now at Weatherhead. But the this is a slide that I like to show to talk about my passion and why I became a heart surgeon, because that's one of the most common questions I get. And for me, it was a pretty fateful day. I showed up as an intern, you know, for my first day of training, and it actually was in Akron for the case folks at Akron General Medical Center. And I showed up that first day and they said to me, you know, look, the internship year is brutal. It's the worst year of your training. And the only way you can survive it is to do two things. One, you gotta stay out of everyone's way. And number two, you gotta not kill anybody. And I thought, I got this, no problem. So I found myself very early on one day, 7 o'clock in the morning, very early, hadn't killed anyone, wasn't in anyone's way. And I was standing outside the operating room board where it was showing all the cases that were going on that day. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, a nurse grabs me and says, oh my God, you know, doctor needs you stat in OR7, and grabs me and throws me into a cardiac operating room, which I'd never even been in, right? And it's total chaos at 7 o'clock in the morning. There's instruments falling on the ground, people running around, a lot of yelling and screaming. And in the middle of all this, there's a patient on an OR table with his chest open and blood shooting up. And the surgeon, who didn't even look up and talk to me in any way, yelled out, get some gloves on and get up here. And I thought, up where all the blood is shooting up? Because if I go there, I'm definitely going to be in everybody's way and I might possibly kill somebody, right? But I found some courage and some bravery and I got some gloves on and I stepped up to the OR table. And I don't know if you can tell, but I have these huge hands. I can, you know, palm a basketball and hold down 13 keys on a piano. And the surgeon said to me, reach in there and hold the human heart. Reach in there, hold the heart, hold it steady for me. And so a large mitted intern is exactly what this guy needed. And I reached in and held the human beating heart. And for me, it was absolutely incredible. It was really the defining moment for me to get on that pathway for heart surgery. And so, you know, in the middle of all this with the patient bleeding out and, you know, and us trying to save his life, I suddenly become a chatty Cathy and I start talking to this heart surgeon. And I said to him, you know, excuse me, do you get to do this every day? And he said, do I get to do what every day? Now, again, he's not even looking up at me, right? Because he's, you know, just trying to save this guy's life. And he said, do I do what every day? And I said, do you get to hold the human heart every day? And finally, this guy looks up at me and he says, well, of course I do. I'm a heart surgeon. And he just goes back to saving the patient's life like I'd said nothing. And for me, it was whammo. I knew that this is what I wanted to do with the rest of my life. And I tell this story because one of the most fundamental things about leadership is finding that passion, right? Finding what it is you want to do with your life and then executing on that. Because great leaders lead with passion. And the other great thing is they find and recognize these moments of inspiration and moments of opportunity. And I tell that story both for the medical folks that are on the call and the entrepreneurs on the call, because that moment may lie ahead of you. So I always tell people you should be constantly scanning your life for moments of opportunity like this, because they can fly right by you and you don't find them. And it can set you on an incredible path for the rest of your life. It certainly did for me. So in addition to being a heart surgeon, I never thought I'd be this, which is a wife and a mom. And I know what you're saying. You're looking at my husband going, ah, look at her. She married an investment banker. She really doesn't really need, or maybe a hedge fund guy. Maybe, you know, she doesn't have to even work anymore. But in fact, I actually married this guy. This is my husband. He's director of liver transplant surgery and director of what's called hepatobiliary surgery, which is surgery of the liver and pancreas at Cedars-Sinai. And you can see he's holding a bag of ice, and that's not because we make margaritas in the OR, though, you know, maybe we'd operate a little better if we did, but there's actually a liver in that bag, a liver transplant. And this is his fourth back-to-back transplant. He's, you know, exhausted. He's got bags under his eyes. He's unshaven, and he's in his happy place. So we are definitely, you know, a two surgeon family. And this is Nick having whacked out a huge, just a big liver mass that he took out with his big thumbs up. And this is actually, you know, how you get a show on television. So, you know, we're a two surgeon family. This is me in the operating room. I look like I'm, you know, pulling a rabbit out of a hat, but I'm actually knuckle deep in someone's mitral valve. And I get a lot of questions about, you know, how does that work with, you know, two surgeons in the household and, you know, a revolving door on the front door. And I always tell people, look, you know, it works great for us. You know, the only thing we ever really squabble about or argue about is which is the more important organ, the heart or the liver. And I always say to my husband, look, if you can buy it in a grocery store and eat it, how important could it possibly be? So I just feel like I win that one. I always win that one. So for me to be a heart surgeon, it took really all of this training, and I'm not obviously going to go through this entire slide, but Nikhil already touched on a lot of my training. I grew up in a little tiny town in upstate New York on a farm. So just to go to college was a huge deal. We had like 70 kids graduate in my high school class. Maybe 5 or 10 of us went on to college. And we had never had a doctor in my family, and we had never had anybody go to medical school from my high school. So just getting out of there was tough. And I owe a lot to Union College in Schenectady for putting me on the pathway, the STEM pathway, to what I eventually became. And you can see I've highlighted Case Western Reserve and Anderson. And look, guys, how far apart you are. Okay, but somehow Elaine and Michael, we brought it all the way full circle. So really excited about that. And I'm happy to talk to you about any of these aspects of my training and all the board exams and things I had to pass. I'm double boarded in general surgery and thoracic surgery. And if you look over at about the, you know, seven, 8 o'clock position, I got my first job at Cedars-Sinai. Directing transplantation and artificial heart technology at the ripe age of 34. So medical student's first paycheck at 34, I blew it on shoes, I'll just be honest. And then managed to have not one, but two children, one between Cedars and getting an MBA. And Elaine knows this, I had a child during business school, which was a blast. And we can certainly talk about what that was like. But I C-sectioned the second kid, so I didn't have to miss final exams. And I actually made it out of Anderson intact with a small, you know, abdominal scar. That's about it. It's the only scar I got from Anderson. Thank you guys so much. But there's two important things that really came out. And this is where I'm kind of shifting the talk a little more to entrepreneurship. But two things that really struck me coming out of Anderson that I learned that I had no idea about when I came in as a doctor, right? One is, you know, being taught about brand. And this is a lesson really for anybody. You don't have to be an entrepreneur or go to business school for this, but knowing who you are as a brand and leveraging that is really critical to who you are and who you can become. Because a brand is simply a unique set of attributes that you have that you can leverage. And I know this sounds crazy, but as a female heart surgeon, you'd think I would know that uniqueness would be something I could leverage. I didn't understand that until I went to business school. And right after Anderson is when I wrote this book that, as you heard from Nikhil, went on to be a New York Times bestseller, which was mind blowing for me, I have to tell you. And we can talk about what it took to get a book actually published. And then went on to be made into a television show when Universal Studios optioned it. But I leveraged this brand as a heart surgeon to build this book, build out sort of that media side, and then leveraged it for some of the work I do on various boards, the work I do on television, really all of it, and then building, you know, a women's health center. So I've really leveraged that to the hilt. But the second important thing, what I want to spend a little bit of time on, is that understand when you're in business school, this is so critical, that the bricks and mortar of your next company are literally sitting in class right next to you. I cannot begin to tell you the networking opportunity that was presented to me from UCLA Anderson. I learned more from the students surrounding me who were frankly brilliant. I mean, the kids I went to medical school were smart. The kids at Anderson, just brilliant. And I learned more from them at times than the professors. No offense, Elaine, but it was this unbelievable thing of being in a Socratic method of learning rather than sort of that rote memorization, which is what I did in med school. That was beautiful. And my whole company was literally built right out of UCLA Anderson. So again, you know, spend that time in B school wisely, get to know your classmates, you know, link up with them, network like crazy, because that is going to build your company. And what happened for me is the very first day of business school, this terrific guy, who I'll introduce in a minute, came up to me the very first day of class. He said, "Oh my gosh, you're a heart surgeon. Oh, I have a PhD in bioengineering and I have this idea. I have this unbelievable idea. I got to tell you about it." Well, Elaine knows this. I was so flipped out about being in business school and freaked out about the fact that there was going to be absolutely nothing about the aorta on the microeconomics exams that I really didn't take anything that this guy was telling me in stride. I kept kind of pushing him off weekend after weekend because I was so worried about, you know, making sure my case studies were done and gosh, were they going to call on me? And did I understand the FedEx case? And I really, for almost a year, just, I don't know how to say it, blew this guy off for a year. It was just terrible. Until the second year at Anderson, he and I found ourselves in an elective, which was entrepreneurial studies by George Abe, the professor at Anderson, who's still there. And the class went like this. George said to everybody in the class, as our professor, he said, "Okay, I want all of you folks to pair up. And I want you to come up with a fictitious idea, make it up. I don't know, a corkscrew, sliced bread, whatever it is, make up this idea. And what I want to do is have you create a feasibility study, a business plan for it. I'm going to bring a bunch of venture capital guys down from Silicon Valley. You're going to pitch it to them like a real thing. And your grade's going to depend on how your pitch goes." Terrific. So what happens? But Mike Witt, Dr. Michael Witt, says to me, "Hey, Kathy, you want to pair up?" And I said, "Okay, great. What are we going to make up?" And he says, oh, I'll tell you what we're going to make up," and proceeds to tell me what his idea is. What his idea was, this is my aha moment that I had in business school, was to take the one tool that every doctor uses just about every day on every patient, a tool that has been around since 1881, which is an ordinary blood pressure cuff, and using a proprietary mathematical algorithm, turn it into a technology that can measure the earliest warning signs of the development of heart disease, way before your blood pressure goes up, your cholesterol goes up, or any imaging study can find it, which is critical to the development of heart disease because it's a disease that's 80% preventable. The problem is we don't find it early enough. We find it when you're, you know, on my OR table. So this was incredible. So we put this whole thing together. We pitched it in front of the VCs. And the next thing I know, the professor says, "I want to see the two of you in my class, in my office after class." And we thought, oh, you know, we totally blew the pitch, right? So we get to his classroom and he says to us, "Listen, I have one question for you guys." And we said, "What?" And he said, is this thing real that you pitched?" So of course, no offense, Elaine, but our instincts were to lie, but we said, "Yeah, this is real," even though we weren't supposed to do that. And he said, "How can I help you? Because I think you have something here." And that, my friends, is one of the beautiful, beautiful things about UCLA Anderson. How can I help you? At every turn, professors and students wanted to help us, and that was just extraordinary. So I want to talk a little bit about how we built the company from literally nothing more than some guy's PhD dissertation. Mike did not embody this technology in what you see on the screen here. We just had an idea. That was it. So the thing that Mike could do, Dr. Michael Witt could do, is measure the health of the lining of your blood vessels, right? So you have about 60,000 miles of blood vessels inside your body. If I were to sew them together end to end, they would literally wrap around the world twice. And every millimeter of every mile of those arteries is coated with this beautiful single cell lining called the endothelium. Think about it like Teflon coating. If I were to scrape that lining out and lay it all over the ground, it would take up between 4,000 and 7,000 square meters of surface area. A tennis court's about 230 square meters. So it's huge. It's actually one of the largest organs in the human body. And what this lining does is it protects you against getting plaque buildup in your arteries that cause a heart attack or a stroke. It prevents your blood from clotting while you're sitting here listening to me. And most importantly is it regulates the expansion and contraction of your arteries in response to flow. The discovery of this was so important, it won the Nobel Prize in Medicine in 1998 by three gentlemen, Furchtkott, Murad, and Ignaro, that came from what institution? Case, folks? They came from Case Western Reserve. So for me, this is full circle because the science upon which our technology was built came out of Western Reserve at the time. And it's actually been touted to be the single most important discovery in the history of cardiovascular medicine. That's how powerful Dr. Michael Witt's idea was. And so what we're able to do with a blood pressure cuff, and I won't go into a lot of detail unless you want to hear about it in the Q&A, is he's able to biohack a human pulse. So as a doctor, I can go to your bedside in the hospital and put my two fingers on your pulse, and I can tell a lot about how you're doing. Is your pulse fast? Is it slow? Is it thready? Is it robust? Is it regular? Is it irregular? It tells me a lot about you. What we can do with this cuff is hack into information that no one else can look at inside a human pulse. And we hack it at about 200 data points per second that gives us information about hardening of your arteries. It turns out that stiffness of the arteries is the very, very first sign of the development of heart disease. So what we do is look at these tones of pressure in your arteries, much like a musical note. So a musical note has harmonics, overtones and undertones that come together to build a single note. Those same tones of pressure are embedded in your pulse that no one is looking at except for us, that tell us about the health of your blood vessels. That's what he can do. Pretty cool. So when you go to build a company from scratch, one of the most important things, and it goes back to my very first slide, is really understanding why. You know, we sat back and took inventory, Mike and I, of why. Why should we be doing this? And I know what drives me. It's because as a heart surgeon, I got pretty frustrated operating on a disease that was 80% preventable. And remember, I'm a heart transplant surgeon. So I'm the one that you get to see when your heart has been decimated by heart disease and we got to chop it out. And that's what we do. We chop it out and put in a new one. So, you know, for me, what drives me is trying to be able to help more patients over a longer period of time by developing a technology to do that. Whereas, you know, in my life as a heart surgeon, I can only operate on one or two people a day. And that's what drives me. And then the next thing you got to do when you build a company is take a core team. And this is our core team. So it's me, Dr. Michael Witt on the far right, also, as I said, an Anderson alum. So Mike and I, as well as Al Fleury, who's a 20-year, you know, life sciences guy who went to some obscure business school called Wharton. I think it's maybe in, I don't know, Pennsylvania somewhere. And we all know what drives us to come together to build Cordex. And that becomes really important as an entrepreneur, that you surround yourself with people who have a vision for why you want to do this. We are a Mibby Wibby company, which is a minority-based, women-based enterprise, which is very unique to have a female and a person of color founding our technology and our company. And what drives Mike and I is it turns out that heart disease disproportionately affects women and people of color. And that is what has always driven this company. And that's really what our addressable market is. So after figuring out your core team, the next thing I would advise when building a company is surround yourself with a bunch of what I call A gamers. When you step into my operating room, you bring your A game, not your A minus game, not your B plus game, your A game. Because if you don't bring your A game to my OR, people die. I treat the company like a patient. And what we did is we built out all this company with people at the top of their field. There's one person in here, which I won't name names, who can neither confirm nor deny that his day job is working at the National Reconnaissance Organization. And what he does is build the algorithms to create on-orbit pathways for what they call on-orbit assets, which is government jargon for satellites. So he repositions satellites so they don't collide with one another. Hopefully not to spy on us, but you can neither confirm or deny that. But the guy is a brilliant mathematician. He's the guy that takes care of our algorithm. That's the kind of team that you need to build. And I'm sorry, can you hear noise in the background?
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah.
Is it overpowering? Because I think there's some people working outside, but I'd have to.
It's good.
It's okay. All right. Great. So the other thing after you build your team out is then we had to build the technology, right? Because again, this is just somebody's idea. So at the top of this slide, you see this, what we call the Frankenstein version of the technology, which is literally a desktop covered with equipment. You know, it was all these tubes and hoses and connected to everything. And then what I love is the right-hand side of that picture where it's a paper and pencil where we were hand calculating the algorithm to make sure it works. This was our original prototype. And what Mike would do is he was in Northern California at San Luis Obispo as a professor in bioengineering at Cal Poly. He would ship it to me in 7 boxes. I'd reassemble it in my garage, very Steve Jobs. And then I'd take it to my hospital. And then we'd test a bunch of patients and I'd package it back up, ship it to him. And then he would look at the algorithm. And that's literally how we started this company. And then what we had to do is start prototyping it. So what you see is that we prototyped several prototypes, but these are sort of a couple of prototypes that we did. The one on the left-hand side, sort of a clunky looking 1929 typewriter-ish thing, was our first prototype. And then we developed a more sophisticated prototype that has a graphical user interface or a GUI screen. And again, all of this takes tremendous time. You got to find people who can design it, people who can manufacture it, people who can write the code, 250,000 lines of code for our algorithm. And all of this is a huge, huge heavy lift, which is why it takes 7 to 10 years to build a medical technology company. The other thing you got to do while you're building the prototype, you got to patent this like crazy. And this is where Anderson sort of stepped in, which was great. And Professor Abe, you know, helped put us in touch with some folks to start building our patent portfolio. We have a really robust portfolio. This is what a healthy portfolio looks like. It's like a tree that extends your patents out from its origination. And so we've got about 14 patents in 23 countries. And I don't know if Bob Pavey from Case Western Reserve is on, but Bob, if you are, you know, as you well know, some of it we kept as trade secrets. So again, having a robust portfolio and think about keeping some of it as a trade secret so it's not out in the public domain is the next phase. And then after you do all that, then you got to start testing. Does my device work? Does it measure what I say I measure? We've tested almost 700 patients in testing this through proof of concept, prototyping, performance testing, observational studies. And we're right at that point where we're embarking on FDA approval with our technology. And so, you know, in the midst of all this though, COVID hit, shut down all research across the United States. We were in the middle of trying to raise capital, that went away. I mean, you have no idea the stumbling blocks, and we certainly can talk about it in developing a technology and building a company. But again, you know, I went to the best and brightest. So Johns Hopkins University is the number one ranked hospital for 21 consecutive years. And when I told my board, I'm gonna go to the number one hospital and have them outsource all of our R&D, they thought I was crazy. But my secret was that I serve on a board at Case Western Reserve, which is called the visiting committee. So it's the dean's private board. Well, who sits on that board? Well, the dean and chairman of Johns Hopkins. So again, networking, folks. I network like crazy. Sat next to him at a board meeting. Next thing you know, they're testing my technology at Hopkins. So again, thank you, Case Western Reserve, for being as equal to UCLA in bringing this company along. And by the way, none of you can have equity, so don't ask. And then after you build all that out, the question is, who's going to pay for this? So I'll just briefly touch on, and then we'll finish up with a couple of principles. And I want to make sure, Michael, we're doing okay on time. But capital raise. Okay, another heavy, heavy lift. So in addition to being CEO and chief medical officer and founder, I'm also what I call the chief capital raise officer. So I have raised every dime of capital for this company. That is exceedingly rare to do. To date, through three rounds of funding, we haven't taken a dime of venture capital funding. We bootstrapped the company initially. Then we funded it with grant money, almost $600,000 in grant money. We won every grant we applied for, both federal and state grants. I then started looking to angel investors. And again, it was all networking. And we raised almost $12 million, which again is a lot, from angel investors. And let me tell you, when I say angels, I'm not talking about, you know, friends and family, you know, low hanging fruit type investors. I'm not talking about crowdsourcing or any of that. My investors include the former CEO of Morgan Stanley, the former CEO of Schwab, the vice chairman of PricewaterhouseCooper, the former CEO of Pfizer, and just for fun, the number one ranked supermodel in the country who is all about women's health. So again, without naming names, and by the way, she's one of my few, you know, female investors, which I'm kind of bummed about, but she's extraordinary and incredibly gifted woman. And so, you know, right now, when Michael, when Hugh reached out to me to do this talk, I was a little bit hesitant because I am like elbow deep right now in raising a $10 million round, as you and I have discussed. And so, you know, I'm doing a heavy lift right now on what is going to be our biggest round. But so far, we've done pretty well. We've got some co-investors, some industry partners coming in. And so it's really been exciting. But again, you're catching me at like probably the worst time you could possibly do it. And what I wanted to mention too is in sort of leading this company, you know, I use a lot of the principles that I mentioned before about leading in an OR. And so, you know, I'm used to leading in the fray, right? You know, give me a good, you know, gunshot wound to the chest, which is what actually this is. And I'm the person on the far left-hand side. And I can tell you, I know how to perfectly handle that. But I had to step up in a pretty crazy way to lead this company. And I'll explain that in a minute. But one of the things I want to tell you is when I think about leading this company, it's very similar to what you're seeing here. In an operating room, I never make an incision greater than the distance between my two fingers in the sternum. And then I focus on that incision for 8 to 10 to 12 to 15 hours, whatever it takes. Now in an operating room, while I'm focused on that incision, I'm talking to the person you see opposite me. That's my assistant surgeon. I'm speaking to the woman in the foreground. She's the clinical nurse who's handing all the instruments to me, what we call a scrub nurse. Behind me is a team of anesthesiologists that I have to talk to about the stability of the patient. And then the other person that you can't see off screen to the left, but you see those red tubes coming down filled with blood, is the person running the heart-lung machine, probably the most important person in an OR. And so what you're constantly doing is interfacing with all these people while you're focused on this one thing. And that is absolutely key to entrepreneurship. You need incredible focus and you need the ability to multitask like crazy, because CEO is not chief executive officer, it's chief everything officer. So I'm gonna finish up by telling you, and I know what you're probably looking, that's going, why am I looking at an X-ray of the human neck? So this is what we call a cervical spine or C-spine. It's a lateral view of the human neck, and those are all the cervical bones in your neck. I got to tell you, I never wanted to be the CEO of this company. I was totally happy to operate full time and be chief medical officer, you know, after hours and on weekends. and found the company and worked with Dr. Michael Witt on the science and the technology. And that we brought on board an amazing CEO, older gentleman, PhD, engineer, founded a whole bunch of companies, sold a couple of companies to J&J. And he was our terrific CEO right up until the point that he sadly fell down a flight of stairs in his home and broke his neck at the C4, C5, cervical root 4-5 interface and became a quadriplegic overnight. So if you all remember Christopher Reeves, he broke his neck in a polo match at C2-3, which is a little bit higher. And the only difference between him and our former CEO is that our former CEO, thank God, didn't have to stay on a ventilator the rest of his life, but he is a complete quadriplegic to date. And when that happened, we were starting what's called first-in-man trials. And those are where you start testing your device in humans. And we were starting our first round of capital. It couldn't have been a worse time. So what happened was my board met. It was actually right on New Year's Eve. The board met. He was in the operating room stabilizing his neck. The board met and we were in full-blown panic mode. And the whole round went down. Every investor said, I'm out, including our lead investor. And the next day, it was a Sunday, I got a call from the lead investor who called me and said, Kathy, give me one good reason why you can't be the CEO of this company. And I choked. I paused. I didn't have an answer. And he said, exactly, and hung up. And he called a board meeting. And the next thing I knew, I was CEO of this company. That's how I stepped up. And I'll tell you, again, both Case and UCLA gave me the leadership skills to step up as CEO overnight in a complete free fall of the company. And one thing I want to tell all of you students who are listening is sometimes leadership's like that. As a physician, those leadership moments are usually big, heroic moments, but in business, they can be moments that happen in a quiet time, in my case, in a pause, in a moment of hesitation. So the next time someone asks you to step up and do something which you don't think you can do, and you don't think you have the guts to do it, and you don't think you have the talent to do it, I'm telling you, do it, because it could change your life. So don't hesitate. So I want to finish up. How are we doing on time, Michael?
We're good. Yeah. This sounds, perfect.
I got about 3 minutes and then.
Sounds good. Perfect.
Sure. Okay. So I just want to talk to you because this is something Nikhil and I remember. Nikhil, we touched a little bit on some things that you asked me to talk about, and it's about guiding principles through really my life and really the breadth of my career. And one of my most important principles is actually failure, which sounds crazy, right? Like, why would failure? Shouldn't success be a principle? And there's a funny, a funny cartoon here, where you zap somebody and you forget to yell clear and you take out, a couple of people on the sidelines. And yes, it happened on Grey's Anatomy. Yes, it may or may not have happened on my show, but I can tell you it did happen in the ER. So believe it or not, this is what failure looks like to a heart surgeon. But why do I talk about failure? Failure is a very big guiding principle for me. You'd think that as a surgeon, we would walk into an operating room thinking about how are we going to succeed? How am I going to come out of this surgery with a healthy, patient, a successful operation? We don't go to an OR thinking about success. We go to an OR thinking about failure. How am I going to kill this patient today? How am I going to come out of this OR with a patient in a body bag? Because it happens. And so we think about risk mitigation every minute of every day. So I go to an OR thinking about how I'm going to fail. I run this company every day thinking about how I'm going to fail every day. And then I just simply mitigate risk because that's what an entrepreneur is really, really good at doing. So when I was at Anderson, I knew that when I got that business degree, I was going to go into entrepreneurship. I wasn't going to go run some big company because it fit hand in glove with who I was as a surgeon. This is a patient that I took care of. I won't say one institution. And he has a huge incision, not the little one from here to here, because I had put in an artificial heart technology to keep him alive while he waited for his transplant. He was in the hospital for months and months and months and finally got his heart transplant. And so I then did his surgical transplant, which was great. He's a police officer and he spent, I don't know, 9-10 months in the hospital, had lots and lots of difficulties and complications, but gosh, you know, he was a win. He made it out. He did great. This is one of my, you know, proudest moments is, you know, discharging this man from the hospital. And then about a week after he was discharged, he went home and he took his revolver, his police revolver. Sorry, this is hard for me. And he shot himself and he came back in, you know, to the hospital, to my hospital, dead on arrival. And I took it so hard, you know, for me, it was an epic fail, right? And I never saw it coming. And I blamed myself and I thought, what did I miss? You know, how could I have done something differently? How could I, you know, how could I miss this? Been taking care of this guy for 9 months. And I have to tell you, no matter what you do, whether I'm talking to you, the med students, or whether I'm talking to you, the entrepreneurs who are on this call, you're going to fail. You're going to fail in a big way. And if you're a physician, your failure can mean death. And I have to tell you that you have to remember, this is so important. And it was so hard for me to understand this, but sometimes failure is beyond your control. Know that you can try your best, mitigate risk as best you can, but know that sometimes it's beyond your control. And I learned about failure as a kid. So this is me on an excavator that I flipped. These are my two brothers. And behind me is that farm. I told you I grew up on an apple farm in upstate New York. And I flipped this thing and then my brothers wouldn't let me play with it anymore, which is kind of sad. But when I grew up, my dad, we didn't talk about failure at my house. And it wasn't that my dad said, you know, failure is not an option. It wasn't that at all. My dad basically said, if you work hard, you can achieve anything. And so I grew up with this notion that if I worked hard, I could be a heart surgeon. I could be an entrepreneur. I could be a mom. I could do whatever I wanted to do if I worked hard at it. And so I really believe these principles are important. And I really believe that failure, if you think about it in the wrong way, failure holds you back because it's a fear of failure that's going to prevent you from starting your next company, from operating on a certain patient, from going into a subspecialty or a specialty that's particularly difficult in healthcare. But I like to reframe failure to this question, which is, think about it this way. What would you do if you knew you couldn't fail? If there was no way for you to fail, what would you do? The answer is you could do anything. And I want you to make sure you reframing failure to this, to not let it hold you back at all from what you want to do, because it is also critical to your leadership. Because great leaders, some of my best leadership moments in an operating room were born out of failure. The other principle I want to mention is what I call dwelling in the house of yes. You know, ladies, not to pick on you or not to pick on us as women, but being a female heart surgeon, I can't begin to tell you the number of times that people told me no. If I had a lousy dime for every time someone told me no, I'd be actually a very rich girl and I wouldn't have to work anymore. You know, no, you can't be a heart surgeon. There's no women heart surgeons. You know, go into pediatrics or OBGYN or plastic surgery. You know, you can't be a mom. You're 40 years old. You're never going to be able to have a baby. You know, no, you can't start this company. You don't even know if this technology works. All I've heard is no, 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 no. You cannot surround yourself with people like that. You have to surround yourself with people who say yes, because those no people are going to deter you from what you're trying to accomplish. And let me tell you something, you know where you find the yes people? You find them at Case Western Reserve, you find them at UCLA Anderson. That's the two places I found people who told me yes. And those are the people you need to surround yourself with. I also think when we think about leadership, and this is just a simple thing, I know as a leader, we have to say no a lot to things, But I think great leaders figure out a way to get to yes a little bit more than no. And lastly, I'll finish up and then I'm just going to show you a brief clip of my show, is one of the most important things, and we've talked about this a little bit already, is you all have to figure out what motivates you to do what you want, to be a doctor, to be an entrepreneur. What motivates you? For me, it's so simple. What motivates me is time. Look at it from my perspective. I see people die who I swear should have lived. And I see people live who I swear to God should have died. And I can't make heads or tails of it other than to tell you that I'm convinced that we all have only a certain amount of time on this earth, a certain amount of heartbeats in our life. And when your time's up, I'm telling you, it's up. So what motivates me every day is to try to do the best with the time I'm given. I'll finish up there with a clip.
What does someone like you love to do in your spare time?
I like long walks on the beach, hot bubble baths, and the sound of cracking a patient's chest open like a lobster.
I'm not leaving without my
dog. I took this job. Breakthroughs
and shirts. What are you doing?
I had a topic transplant.
There are four doctors in the world who know how to do this.
That'll be five. If your patient dies, the committee will fire you. Bite me. Emergency operation. I need lights and sirens. Thank you, guys. Use lights and sirens.
Mr. DeLuca needs surgery.
I don't want your pretty fine me to look at.
Oh, I love the smell of woman burning first thing in the morning.
But I want right now.
Now? No, no.
And I want it back.
No, my back is good.
Lives. High risk, high reward, and a chance to change the world. If you have a boss.
So go out and change the world, everybody. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for your time here today, Dr. Magliato.
Thank you.
And are you open to an open Q&A really?
For like? Yeah, sure. Whatever you guys want. What do you want to do?
All right. That sounds perfect. So I'd like to open up the floor for any questions. You answered my question. What's your number one motivator?
Oh, there you go.
So yeah, as you have questions, anyone can just use the raised hand feature and I'll add you onto the list.
Great. And I'm happy to stay on, you know, as long as you want for Q&A, whatever you got. Because I'm looking at the time. I had no idea I talked that long. Elaine knows I talk a lot.
This is Hugh.
Hi, Hugh.
I have a question. Unfortunately, I went to college down the street from Case. Toward downtown, but you kept on hitting on networking, and the company that I'm working for, neither the owner with her degree or my degrees have that networking built out. One of the biggest problems we're having is finding jobs. We do medical devices, but on the R&D side, we also make some production parts for the GE's MRI machines, but we can't bust out of what we've been pigeonholed into. Mm-hmm. How do you get to, for us, we've been around for a while. How do you get into the buyers? How do you network into getting what you have done?
Yeah.
And duplicate it as quote unquote a small company, I guess would be the best way.
Yeah.
Because she went to University of Akron, UT. I'm Cleveland State, University of Dayton, in AFIT, which is Erfurt Institute of Technology.
Yeah.
But I don't have that network that you were talking about,
yeah.
Nor does she.
Yeah.
So how do we develop that network so we can grow the company?
Yeah. Can you hear me with that noise? I feel really, I can go, okay. So Hugh, you know, I have to tell you, so I've built a network. I mean, I've just been a lifelong networker. I mean, it's taken me, it's not like I grew that overnight. I'm constantly networking. I literally will take a business card to a public bathroom, to a women's room. And I'm it's not beneath me to hand it under a stall. I literally have done that, you know? And so I'm a consummate networker. Networking requires putting yourself out there, and it requires having a story. So, you know, in B school, they talk to you a lot about elevator pitch. You need an elevator pitch. So you all need to sit down and figure out, you know, again, about leveraging your assets, about figuring out who you are as a brand. You all need to sit down and powwow and think to yourselves, okay, who are we as a company? Who do we want to be? What's our trajectory? What's our vision, right? And then how do we project that vision in a succinct elevator pitch, 13-second fashion? And once you have that, then you can take it on the road. But you have to have those tools to begin with. And again, this is stuff that we were taught in business school. And then it's a question of you working together as a team to sit down and think, okay, so what does our network look like? You just mentioned three institutions to me that you could literally contact, and I would contact, you know, their tech transfer office or their offices that work in entrepreneurship, and start to put yourself out there. You know, perhaps it's something as simple as offering to give a lecture or offering to come in and speak about your company and what you're doing. I think it's even easier to build your network now because you've got the tools that I never had, which is, you know, basically social networking and LinkedIn. And so, you know, potentially hiring someone to be able to start doing that, to be able to use Instagram and Twitter, and maybe it's a question of, you know, you having the right marketing person in there as well to do it. But again, I literally will be pitching on a line in a grocery store. I don't know. It's some of it is art and some of it is science. I can tell you, when I was at Cedars, I built from the ground up an artificial heart technology program with nothing more than a pager and a phone. And that was it. And I ran around to all the hospitals in Southern California, and I gave lectures at their institutions telling them about our program that I was building. And I gave them my pager at the time. And people would have patients crashing with heart failure, and they'd call me, and I'd swoop in with a helicopter, pick them up, bring them back, and stabilize them and save them. And that's how I built it. So I've been doing this a long time. I hope that gives you a little bit of insight.
All right, thank you for your question, Hugh.
Yeah.
Next question comes from Victoria Wang. You can briefly introduce yourself and give your question.
Hi, Dr. Magliato. Thank you so much for your time. Hi, it was so inspiring. So I'm a fourth year med student at Case. And my question is, so you decided to go to business school, and I'm just curious where, when you think is the most optimal time to do it, since a lot of residency and med schools are now incorporating it into their curriculum, like MD MBAs or doing an MBA during residency.
Yeah, I couldn't imagine, you know, doing that during residency, but, you know, in my residency at Akron, which was 5 years in general surgery, I took a year and did a research stint in heart and lung transplant research in rats at the University of Michigan. So I was able to carve out a year, but again, I'm speaking from the perspective of a general surgery 5-year residency. I can imagine that that might be tough to say to them, hey, I want to step out for a year, you know, go to B school. Now Anderson, I can tell you, is 23-month program. I did an executive MBA program. I'm not sure what Weatherhead offers, but I think it really is when you would have that time in life, because I had no appreciation for the level of work that I had to do at Anderson. So we met every weekend, and between classes on the weekends, it was 40 to 60 hours worth of work. I was operating at the same time. I mean, it was really, really tough, but I did it. I guess I was probably 6 years after I started as an attending surgeon at Cedars that I went back and got a business degree, but I was also operating at that time. So I somehow fitted in. It is a heavy, heavy lift. I had no idea. And I remember walking out of an economics exam. Again, that was my kryptonite. And Victor Tabush, you know, Elaine was the dean at that time. And I walked out and I was crushed from the exam. And I had this horrible look on my face, and he came up to me, he said, "What's wrong?" I said, I just bombed that exam, bombed it. And he said to me, "Kathy, I've been wanting to tell you this, but you of anyone will learn the most here at Anderson because you've come in as a sort of tabula rasa, you know, a clean slate, you know nothing about business. So everything you learn is fresh and new." And so the other thing I want to mention, Victoria, is when it comes to timing, your mind has to be open to this learning. It's intense, it's rigorous, it's a blast. It's a whole different way of learning than med school. So you have to be, you know, have to have the intellectual curiosity and maturity to really want to grab that information as well. So sometimes timing is about, you know, the physical timing of it, but some of it is also about the, when can I have the mental capacity to absorb the stuff that I'm learning in business school. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. Thank you.
Yeah. And by the way, I did fail. I got an F. I just, for the record, just bombed.
I just want to say, this is Mahmoud Gannoum. It's a great, great lecture. I really enjoyed it. And it's unbelievable because you embodies the passion that is really needed to become an entrepreneurial person, you know? And I am with George Jankowski, and I direct the entrepreneurial pathway. And I tell you, you embodied what is needed, the journey, if you want to go, and how hard it is, you know? The other thing I want to comment, since I did also executive MBA at Weatherhead, which Weatherhead does it actually. Yeah. And you know, I can't agree with you more. You need to have the passion to do it. And I help a lot of companies develop their antifungals. I am a fungi, you know, I work with, you know. So, and because I dealt with so many pharmaceutical companies, I thought, you know, I need to know their language, these people, what they talk about. And then when I did that, it is like unbelievable. It's what you said. You really need to be ready for that, and you need to have the passion, because I have two labs running. I have too many things, yet I really enjoyed it. But the most important thing, which you alluded to, you get to meet people from different disciplines, and you learn so much from them. So yeah. I really want to thank you for your great, great lecture.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. And, you know, I'm a transplant surgeon, so we hate fungi, aspergillus, I'm a lung transplant surgeon, so, you know, we hate cryptococcus, all that kind of stuff. But no, I love what you said. And like I was saying before, you know, is the really good professors, you know, at Weatherhead and Anderson will, you know, create that environment where the students, you know, tee off each other with information. And, you know, the beautiful thing about sort of being pregnant in the second half of my B school is that they would stick me in the back of the class, closer to the bathroom, to the restroom. And then I wouldn't get called on as much. But what would be crazy is, you know, the professor would call on me and say, you know, Kathy, so we're looking at this, you know, I'll use FedEx, you know, this FedEx case. And I just, you know, I know you read it last night, and I'd just like to get your thoughts on, you know, this or that strategy for how they moved from this, you know, distribution route to this and this. And I'd start to answer, and I'd think, oh, I just answered so brilliantly, because, you know, brilliance. And then some guy like three seats down would say, you know, when I worked at FedEx, blah, 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 blah. And he would know that, he would understand, and he would have that case cold. And you have to be open to learning like that. You have to be open to being challenged. And, you know, being a surgeon isn't like that. You know, it's my OR, you don't challenge me. It was incredible to be challenged by brilliant, brilliant minds who would see things so differently. Because the operating room isn't about seeing things differently. It's about a well-orchestrated plan that you execute so everybody sees it and executes it exactly that way every single time. And I really loved the multifactorial perspectives on cases and case study. Just fascinating. But again, back to what Victoria said, you know, when do you do this in your life? It's just a tough question. You got to have the time, the dedication. You can't, you know, do it halfway. You can't say, well, I'll put in 20 hours this week, not 40. I would literally carry my books in my car, my Anderson books, and at every opportunity, I would just pull over and read. I mean, it was just, when we would go do a transplant, I'd be in a helicopter. I'd be helicoptering to get an organ at some other institution. I'd be reading my business school books. crazy.
No, I don't want to take the time. I don't want to take the time, but you really remind me so much. I used to go, you know, in the days of pre-pharma, you go give talks to clinicians and whatever. So I go from Cleveland to Cincinnati, sitting in the back of the car, you know, the limo. And what I'm doing, reading my business stuff. So it's a great. Anyway, sorry, I don't want to.
Yeah. I highly recommend it. And I really think that physicians should get MBAs. I think that healthcare is the, no offense, and I know this is being recorded, but healthcare is the worst run business out there. And the fact that doctors don't know more about business is an atrocity. So I really hope that the students that are on, you know, that are listening today who are on the physician side, and I know you're in the entrepreneurial studies class, but getting a business degree is to me critical for being, I think it's the leaders of where medicine needs to be. Yeah.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Ganoum.
Thanks.
Dr. Magliato. We have time for two more questions. Our next question comes from Scott.
Hello, Dr. Magliato. Thank you so much for... excuse me?
Hey, Scott.
Oh, hey there. Thanks for a super inspiring talk. I'm a first-year med student. I'm also a machine learning engineer, really interested in software entrepreneurship as well. So the one thing that I'm really curious about you and your path is you're such a dynamic presenter. You're so good at harnessing those stories, communicating that. I know I was super engaged. I think the whole audience really loved your talk. And obviously you've been successful in communicating those stories because you've raised a lot of money. That doesn't sound like a skill that you learned in med school. How did you develop those skills, become so good at presenting, at communicating your vision and getting other people on board with your vision? Because I think that's a really important skill to have.
Well, you know, again, I would say that some of it is med school in some sense, because, you know, I'm used to presenting science, right? So, I mean, you know, I've given a lot of talks, a lot of presentations, that type of thing. I think you have to be open to the personality of it. I think, you know, being on television has helped. A lot of times I'm asked to be, you know, every time a celebrity drops dead from heart disease, I get, you know, my phone blows up and everybody, you know, wants me on ABC or Fox or CNN or whatever. And you have to learn to synthesize information and then send it back to people in a way they can digest and understand. So taking complex information about disease and packaging it in a way that anyone can understand, that's a skill I learned in med school and in my residency, because every time you leave an operating room, you go out and talk to the family, right? You say, you know, here's how the surgery went. If I went out and talked to a family and said, well, here's the thing, we cross-clamped the aorta, we put in 7-0 stitches, I then did a Lima to LAD graft, we were on pump, I don't know, 44 minutes, they would not understand what I'm talking about. So I learned very quickly about being able to speak to a family about some really complicated stuff that happens inside of an operating room. And I think that's the way I've been able to learn to communicate in a way that's understandable and presentable. And then it really was then Anderson that helped me with pitching, right? So they taught us a lot about, you know, again, I go back to the elevator pitch, but they taught us a lot about pitching, presenting, formulating ideas, that type of thing. But so some of it is innate, I will say, Scott. Some of it is just, you know, I guess, growing up as a loud Italian in upstate New York. But some of it's innate, but really you learn it along the way. And it really starts with just talking to patients in a way that they understand you. and making that beautiful connection with a patient, which is, God, one of the most incredible things is to sit on the bedside of a patient and just talk to them. And then from there, I just built it. And then I honed it at Anderson. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah, that's really great insight.
Thank you. Great question.
Thank you very much. And then our final question will come from Elaine.
Uh-oh. Oh,
thanks, Nikhil. This is more than a little bit of a comment to you and following up on the others. We had a campaign here a few years ago where we often refer to a lot of our alums as the UCLA optimist. And I just think Kathy is the relentless optimist. And I, you know, this is 15 years of work, if not 17. And I remember some of the early breakfasts when there weren't as many venture capitalists around. And we, you know, initially we were looking at some of the, I say we, because like we all feel like everyone who went to our school or like we're all part of the process. But then switching to these like professional angels, as we call them, really was the difference. But I just the passion and the optimism that you have for this, and then the perseverance and not giving. I just think we all needed this talk today. So I just want to say thank you, because as everyone, I'm leaving inspired. I think everyone else is too.
Thank you. And I love the word you use, because if people asked me to describe my company in one word, it would be perseverance. It would be resilience. I mean, we got slammed by COVID-19. We've come back from so many things. It's incredible. But you're right. It is hard work. It is getting out of bed every day and pushing a rock up a hill, and you have no idea how far you're going to get. And maybe you won't get far at all that day, and you have no idea about outcome. I mean, again, I don't have a crystal ball. I have no idea how this company is going to end. Is it going to be successful? Is it going to be an IPO? Am I going to get a huge M&A, or is it going to just go up in smoke? I guess my investors don't want to hear that. But look, they know the risks. This is the risk of a startup. I mean, you know, but I love risk, and I actually love not knowing. I mean, I'm excited to do what I do every day. Thanks.
Thank you for the insight. Before we wrap it up, I'd just like to say thank you so much for the inspiration here. To me, like, the biggest takeaways were be motivated by your failures, recognize you have limited time, so do as much as you can to say yes, meet as many people as you can, and then finally, those attributes about yourselves that some people may consider obstacles or setbacks, turn them into your assets and run with that as your brand. Yeah. So thank you for this inspirational talk today.
Great. Thanks, Nikhil. Thank you. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you for joining us. And I'd like to hand it back to Mike.
Just very briefly, Elaine, I loved your comments. Actually, I was thinking the exact same thing. I was just, you know, hey, we've all been on Zoom for a lot of sessions over the last, you know, 19 months. And sometimes you have a session where it's like, it just, you couldn't be happier to connect with alums in LA and partner with Anderson around this and be with Bright Med students and others. So yeah, this is one of our best sessions. I don't say that to everybody, Kathy. This was truly a great session. And I love the way that you sort of thoughtfully took us through your career and brought in, because we have folks that are med students, entrepreneurs. So it was a great session. So thank you for coming back to Case Western Reserve. And again, it was great to partner with UCLA. We do have a bunch of future events as we wind down the semester. So check out our website for that. And Elaine, hopefully we'll find a way to continue to partner together. So Kathy, thank you again. Thank Nikhil, great job moderating, and happy Thanksgiving to everybody.
All right, thank you. Lots to be thankful for. Thank you.
Have a good one.
Thank you.